Can you talk to us a little bit about who Nancy and Leo are as people and the extraordinary things that Emma and Daryl brought to those roles?
Well, Nancy is a woman of around 60 who is recently widowed, who was a teacher and a real stalwart of her community, someone who was always volunteering, you know, sort of ran the local this, ran the local that, always available for the jumble sale, the tombola, a good mum, you know, does all her marking before she does anything else. And it was, so she was a sort of person that had never really quite had the boldness to put herself first and think about what she wanted. And so for the first time, that's what she's done, and she's taken the initiative. And when Emma Thompson came on board with it, she seemed to recognise that immediately about Nancy and understand that intrinsically. And so she just took it in the way that she of course would, as a world-class actress, top of her game, and just made it much better. And Leo is somebody who has a kind of alter ego, a professional alter ego, as Leo Grande, as a sex worker, and he's very proud of that. He's very professional and he's very good at it. But underneath that is a man as well, with his own complications and histories. And the point is that the two of them talk and create an environment where they can be safe together. And so these two actors, Daryl and Emma, just took what I wrote and, with Sophie as the director, just made it bloom into this extraordinary thing that was better than I could ever have imagined. Well, it was an idea I've had for years, about the idea of a woman, perhaps in her sort of around the age of 60, who has been married to one man who has recently died and has realised that she's never had a good sexual experience in her life, and that she feels embarrassed about that and frustrated by that, and that she hires a young male sex worker to help put that right, and she's waiting in the room in the hotel for him to arrive. And I had that as an opening in my head for quite a long time, and I just wanted to see what happened, and I just felt the only way I could see is to write it myself. And so I began to write them, and began to write these two characters making their story together, and communicating and connecting and finding that intimacy, not just sexually but also verbally, emotionally, humorously. It was very important to me that it was funny, and that they were funny people finding each other funny, and that that whole environment just really was about encouraging intimacy. And that's something I've always been fascinated with, is how you create intimacy, what it does to you, pleasure, joy, not being ashamed of any of those things. And all of that was just encapsulated in this scenario. I wouldn't say it's a metaphor, I'd say it's just a very direct representation of that description of putting women in boxes and freeing yourself. It doesn't mean you hate all the boxes, it just means that's not all you are. And I think we've talked a lot about what do you want as a woman, or even just as a person, to drown out the noise of other people needing things from you all the time. And sometimes it's all right to just sit and think, what do I want? And to just take a little bit back. And I think, yes, there's pressure on all of us to be like that, but particularly culturally, women do tend to be the ones wondering, what do they want, are they okay, done, and you're last on the list. And so I wanted to be involved in making something and writing something where a woman put herself top of the list, even just for an hour and a half, and so that's what we did. I just thought, let's find a woman who is about to release herself from all of that duty in a room with a man that she's hired to help her with that, and to just be free of all of that, because he's essentially a stranger, and therefore she can start to define herself against a new kind of a new standard for herself somehow. She can recalibrate herself and her sense of pleasure and what she is entitled to ask for, not from another human necessarily, but just from life and from herself. And I that is something that I find a very exciting prospect as a story, as a character, and as a person. You know, that's how I want to live my life. I'm not presenting myself as somebody who's got a lot of answers. I've just got a lot of questions, and I just like to ask them and then see what other people think. So that's it, yeah. Don't feel bad about a single solitary thing. Just get on with it. Find your pleasure, find your joy, and don't feel bad about it. Whatever it is, just pursue it and find it, because really that's all that's important, you know, and that's what I would say, and that's what I would have said to myself as a young girl too. I'd had the idea for some years, but not really done anything with it. And then in January 2020, I set a week aside to just write this thing and get it out of my head and find out what happened, because I tend to think while I write. And I wanted to know the story. I wanted to know, and I just thought, I need to write this then. So I wrote the first draft in a week, because that's all I had really. And I thought, no one will ever see this, so it's fine. I can just do whatever I want. And that first draft, it was a little bit short. The end was a bit weird. But initially, the first two-thirds of it felt like, yeah, there's something here. And so I put it away. But then when it came into, when I gave it to Debbie Gray, the producer, and then Emma came on board, Sophie, Daryl, and the whole thing was happening, well, then we needed to do some work on the script. And I think we did about, 11 drafts. But that's what it needed. And we just kept tweaking it, and then we locked it, and they shot it. And yeah, so that was a great experience for me creatively.